grace to you. I don't know what, why Dr. John MacArthur is engaging in this situation out in California the way he is, but my advice to all pastors, and especially black pastors, because our community is far more vulnerable, to not follow Dr. John MacArthur on this. This is not wise. And here's why. I'm getting ready. I'm reeling some things off to you. And I do this every time I do this briefing. So let me just say this first one again. These are the reasons. I don't have to give you any reasons other than dead bodies of saints. That's reason enough. This thing is not playing. This coronavirus plague does not play. It does not care whether or not you're the First Baptist Church of Dallas or the Grace to You Ministries or... And this plague, I believe, is against the church, first and foremost. And our hypocrisy, our phoniness, our fakeness, our acquiescing to evil, our compromising, and just because you're faithful individually doesn't mean everybody in your church is. And so many people are compromised and have compromised against God. And I do pray that there are some whole churches that are standing firm, as Jesus would have you to do. And if there ever was a church that would be like that, it would be, no doubt, Dr. John MacArthur's church. But my advice to all pastors, red, yellow, black, and white, and all church members is to stay home. And I don't have to give you any reasons. Look at all of our briefings, and just from our briefings alone, you're going to find 1,000 people probably have died because of getting the coronavirus at the church. It's just not wise. And it's not necessary. It's not necessary. John MacArthur has been using technology for years. He reaches millions of people via radio. Now, I believe the church ought to be free to meet if they want to meet. And the government is free to pronounce limits and restrictions. That's their job. And if we are to be good Christians, we ought to obey the magistrates if they're not telling us to do anything evil or wrong. The church has always been essential, as one pastor said, out of New York, and it is essential today, and even more so. And not only that, the church can still meet without a building. See, what is essential is the church, not your building. You don't have to get people out there. And we've already seen a Herman Cain, a Christian man, whether you like him or not, he was a real Christian and a real black man. He was not a phony black man. He was a real black man. He had different beliefs. And he committed some sins, like David, like the rest of us. But he was a born-again Christian. I know of his pastor, one of the Spurgeons of our time, Dr. Cameron Alexander. He went out there, you know, doing this rah-rah stuff for Trump out in Oklahoma. He was dead in a few weeks. So... don't be foolish, people. Be wise as serpents, harmless as doves. The church is rolling on just fine at home, as it did 2,000 years ago. The church never has been big on building. We made that in recent years. In recent history, rather. The church has never been about the building. We make it about the building because that's how we are by nature. Church is going to meet. John MacArthur, he had several thousand the other day. The truth of the matter is, and he knows it, his staff knows it, they can have 100,000 and probably have had 100,000 in services online. And I believe that this is an unnecessary fight. And I don't know of Dr. John MacArthur being political in any way. He's concerned about the country like everybody else, but I don't think he's a Trump man or anything like that. I've never seen him that way. But I think this is an unnecessary fight, people. Because politicians need the church. And you will see them every 2 years, every 4 years, begging for your vote and your support. So I don't see the government picking on churches. I think that's a false fight. When the government says you can have services, but limited to 100 people, so the people can spread out. Some of them are Christians or believers, and they know how Christian people are and how we do, and how sometimes we walk along that line of faith and foolishness. And we see somebody, I miss your hug. Come in, give me that hug. I know you ain't got no coronavirus plague. You know, we either head or not tail. See, they know all this. That's why they do this. And they're looking at the numbers of how many people are getting sick through churches across the nation. These are facts. And I'm going to keep on reeling them off to you so that you will make the right decision and do the right thing. Nobody's trying to steal your church, man. Nobody's trying to infringe upon your rights to meet. You're looking at it the wrong way. Sometimes we fighters, we just want to fight about everything. And this is nothing to fight about, man. Because you're going to end up dead. You're going to have people who will be dead in your church, and all you can say is, I'm sorry. And then you're going to shut down the services, but they're dead. Especially a church like Dr. MacArthur's church. Not that many black folk, but they have a whole lot of older people. And can God protect them? Yes. Will God do so? I don't know. But I do know if you're going to gather together like that with this plague out here, and California is almost the number one state now, that's just not wise, and your church is going to be beset with lawsuits. It's unnecessary. It's a necessary fight. And Dr. John MacArthur is probably the best preacher today outside of Dr. Tony Evans, Dr. T.D. Jakes, and he might even beat them as far as he's one of the few preachers who can just read the manuscript from the pulpit with his head down and just be just as powerful as he can be in the Lord. One of the few. It's just amazing the power of God. And have a packed house and reading the manuscript. The only other preacher I know who does that is John McNeil Jr. But he looks up sometimes. So I believe the best preacher who can use technology out here, believe it or not, is Pastor John MacArthur. He's got the team, he's got the money, they can flat do it. He can have 100,000 people every Sunday or more online. And that's how it ought to be. And so right now, we need to, pastors need to be training their people to have church at home. Because this, if the church does not repent, if America does not repent, the government does not repent of this homosexual foolishness, which John MacArthur is against big time and has broken it down very thoroughly. This is going to not only continue, it's going to get worse. So you can't, what I'm saying to you other pastors, you can't, you're not John Maxwell. You're not John MacArthur. He's a prophet of God. I've called him a prophet of God for years. He's a prophet of God. He's a man of God on another level. You're not him. So don't go out here trying to do what he is doing, because it may be a situation like this where the devils and demons will come and say, Jesus I know, Paul I know, John MacArthur I know, but who are you? Don't mess with, don't try to be, don't, you do what the Lord leading you to do. According to Channel 18, Lexington, Kentucky, a church. Did I finish the first one? I did? Okay. Thank you. According to Channel 18 in Lexington, Kentucky, a church in Berea, Kentucky, has suspended in-person services after a coronavirus outbreak with at least 20 cases. Okay, I'm just giving you the facts, the news facts. These are not made up stories. According to WSOC-TV 90, nearly 100 members of Faith Baptist Church in Shelby, North Carolina, have tested positive for coronavirus. And see, people, you need to understand, you don't even want to be, you don't even want to test positive for this thing. That's going to mess with your psyche. Big time. You don't even want to test positive for this and then try to fight it. You don't want it. You don't want it. According to WIBW, 22 cases of coronavirus have been linked to Faith Tabernacle Church in Junction City, Kansas. So this, am I just giving you these stories? I don't have to give you any reasons, people. I'm just giving you these stories. Many, many church folk have died already. Thousands have died from the coronavirus plague, from trying to meet up at church. And one pastor had to apologize to the congregation on video. You don't want to be in that situation. You don't want to be responsible for, I know you got people signing waivers and all of that. That's wicked. Don't do that. I guess you're more concerned about the church properties and monies than you are the souls of the people. I mean, the lives of the people. You don't want to be in that situation, Pastor. The people died, faithful saints of the church, who would still be here if you had not, because they're going to follow you. The truly God-called pastors, and some who are not, if they wanted the people to come, the people, and they insisted, and they contacted them, they will come. Many will come, because they believe in you to be the man of God. Don't put them in that situation. According to ABC News, the pastor of Eastern Star Missionary Baptist Church in Toledo, Ohio, and four of his church members have tested positive for the coronavirus. According to the Winston-Salem Journal, 4 children and 2 staff members of the Crossing Preschool After School in Kernersville, North Carolina, which is operated by First Christian Church, have tested positive for the coronavirus plague disease. According to WXIA TV, 4 different schools in Cherokee County, Georgia, have seen positive coronavirus tests. 3 different schools had a student test positive, leading to quarantines for classmates who were in close contact, and at one school, a kindergarten teacher tested positive. All of the students in that class have been ordered to quarantine. All told, there are 60 quarantine orders related to coronavirus in the district. See, this coronavirus plague is so everywhere and so powerful and so contagious that it's going to send you back. See, and this is why I told people, I've been teaching people and encouraging people for a couple of months now to prepare to homeschool your children, because I knew this was going to happen. You're going to send your children out there, a bunch of folks going to get sick, and they're going to shut down the whole school. Now you got a child that you don't know is going to live or die. You don't know if you're going to live and die, because you went out here and did something that is just foolish. If a hurricane came, and most of us would not go out there and mess with the hurricane. We wouldn't send our children out there. But you have a virus that is a hurricane. It's a deadly hurricane. Somebody said today that this coronavirus matter is just like 9/11. No, this is way worse than 9/11, man. What are you talking about? This can't touch, 9/11 can't touch this. 3,000 died, and that's tragic. We're talking about over 200,000 already, and it's going to go across 1 million. According to the Louisville Courier Journal, at least 7 schools in Indiana have had students or staff contract the coronavirus plague, with one school reporting 4 students testing positive in the first week of classes. According to the New York Magazine, 6 students and 1 school staff member have tested positive for the coronavirus in Corinth, Mississippi. Now, 116 people who were in close contact with those who tested positive have been sent home on a 2-week quarantine. Now, see, folks, this is a mess. See, if one person gets sick, 2, 3, whatever, small number, the whole school's got to shut down. That's a big old mess right there. It's a big old mess. What you try to prevent, you know, your children from staying home, is going to happen anyway, and you're not prepared for it. Now they're home and possibly sick. Now you're concerned about your child being sick, and now you're concerned about getting sick yourself and your child being left behind. And the coronavirus will take parents and leave the children behind. That's a fact. That's happening. That has happened. Nobody's trying to scare you. I'm just reading what the news is as gathered by our staff here. According to CBS News, all 4th graders at a Thales Academy in Wake Forest, North Carolina, are under quarantine after one. Now, wait, up there, see, in that area, you got some of the best medical training universities and so forth in the world of their Wake Forest in that whole area there. And this is happening right there. One of the most high-tech areas of the nation. After one student tested positive for coronavirus plague, one. According to the Tennessean, at least 25 school districts have closed schools or altered their schedules as a result of exposure to the coronavirus plague. 97 confirmed coronavirus cases connected to schools have been reported. That's in Tennessee. What am I saying to you from by sharing these news stories? Keep your children home. Homeschool your children. As you know, I'm helping you to do that. My wife and I, we did that since the time they were born, 7 children, all the way through college with multiple degrees. And the 3 who have already left, they're doing very well by the grace of God. I heard from my oldest son today. He sent me $300. I didn't ask him to send it, he just sent it on his own. And all of my children are still in their 20s, and all 3 of them do that. And they do that on their own. And so there's great value in teaching your own children, raising your own children, staying home with your own children, and keeping them with you until they finish school. One of the reasons why you want to get rid of your children so fast is because they are disobedient and rebellious. And you can help with that. And at least tap it down, make it controllable so that you can work with them and help them to understand all that bad attitude and all that sass, as the old folks used to call it, and rebelliousness is under control and it's not going to work when they get out into the real world or if they get into their own marriage. None of that foolishness is going to work. And if they are still under your roof, you need to help them understand that. See, you can't train a child and teach a child anything if you don't discipline the child. And they're not going to learn anything if you don't discipline them. And you have some people, as Dr. Dobson talked about, who are strong-willed. They're proud, stubborn, rebellious, disobedient. And you got to work on them. You got to whip their butts and help them to understand that is not God's way and that is the devil's way, and you're not going to make it in life being proud, stubborn, rebellious, and disobedient. Don't send them out into the world like that, because they're not going to make it. They're going to end up in jail, or they're going to kill somebody, or they're going to be killed. That's what's wrong with so many children today. They leave too soon. According to The Hill magazine, the United States on Wednesday suffered the highest number of coronavirus deaths since May, with 1,503 deaths. According to the Washington Post, the U.S. reported nearly 56,000 new coronavirus cases, the highest daily tally in 4 days, as communities around the country face decisions on whether to reopen schools in the fall and testing trends for the virus vary across states. I'm just briefing you from multiple publications, helping you to understand the patterns and see the patterns and understand the patterns and see what's going on so that you can make the right decisions. Number one, I've already told you, you don't need to go to the church building, but you do need to go to church. And number two, you do not need to send your children to any school, public, Christian, private, where there's a group of people. Don't send your children out there, because children are getting the coronavirus plague and they are getting sick and dying. A Georgia boy, 7 years old, died of the coronavirus plague last week, I think it was. And it's being brought to the parents, and they're dying, and they'll die faster. Grandparents will die faster than that. According to CNBC News, Florida reported a record 276 new coronavirus deaths on Tuesday, marking the highest number of deaths reported in a single day by the state since the pandemic began, bringing the total number of coronavirus plague deaths in Florida to nearly 10,000 now. According to Bloomberg News, pharmaceutical and public health experts are saying that the coronavirus plague pandemic is likely going to be a challenge for years to come, even with a vaccine. And like I told you, more than half the people in America are not going to take a coronavirus plague vaccine. They won't even take the flu vaccine. And I can tell you right now, some black folks in the South, you're not going to give me the coronavirus. That's what they're going to say to you. Mm-mm. No, sir. Mm-mm. You're not going to put that in my body. According to the BBC News, coronavirus infections are surging in France, Germany, and Spain again. Germany has recorded its biggest daily increase in coronavirus cases in more than 3 months, with more than 1,200 cases reported in the past 24 hours. Spain is facing the worst coronavirus infection rate in Western Europe, with 1,418 new infections in its latest daily count on Tuesday, and said there were 675 active outbreaks in the country. By the way, one teacher resigned today because there was so many problems with people wanting him to teach in the class. And then the public school system, they won't let him teach from home. He has to come to the school. And he said because the ventilation is bad, they don't have it set up properly. He resigned today, a teacher. Resigned. He said, I'm not going to do that. I'm not doing that. If I can't teach from home, I'm not going to do it at all. According to the AP, New York's coronavirus death toll in nursing homes, already among the highest in the nation, could actually be a significant undercount. Unlike every other state with major outbreaks, New York only counts residents who died on nursing home property, and not those who were transported to hospitals and died there. that statistic could add thousands to the state's official care home death toll of just over 6,600. But so far, the administration of Democratic Governor Andrew Cuomo has refused to divulge the number, leading to speculation the state is manipulating the figures to make it appear it is doing better than other states and to make a tragic situation less dire. According to Yahoo News, the CDC has reported that the coronavirus plague pandemic has led to a marked deterioration in Americans' mental health and has driven Americans to depression and drinking. According to Bloomberg News in Memphis, Tennessee, and Irvine, California, schools are having teachers sign, watch this, liability waivers. Got your workers signing liability waivers in case they get sick from the coronavirus. That's so sad and so pathetic. According to the Washington Post, coronavirus fatigue is gripping America as there is no end to the plague pandemic in sight. According to Hawaii News, now the coronavirus plague is spreading in Hawaii at a faster rate than anywhere else in the nation, as the state is regularly seeing triple-digit increases in infections. According to the New York Post, Governor Andrew Cuomo stated that visitors from Hawaii, South Dakota, and the U.S. Virgin Islands coming into New York will have to quarantine for 2 weeks. According to the Los Angeles Times, a disastrous situation unfolding at San Quentin State Prison shows how any effort to achieve herd immunity would come with enormous costs in terms of illness and death. According to ESPN, the Pac-12 has officially announced that the 2020 fall football season has been canceled due to the coronavirus plague. Now, if college folks are canceling football and willing to lose billions of dollars, you might want to stay home from public gatherings, even at the church, and you might want to keep your children from gathering with others at a school. Just use common sense, people. Use some love in your heart for your own children and not let them do that. Don't put them in that situation. Don't put yourself in that situation, because here's what's going to happen to you. As soon as you drop your children off, you're going to be worrying the whole day long, no matter what else you think you got planned to do. And then you're going to be worried when you pick them up. Who did this? Did everybody wear a mask? Did everybody stay in their circle? And if he told the truth, the answer is going to be no. Your children won't stand in a circle at your house. They don't keep the mask on when they're with you. So what are you talking about? Mom, I can't breathe. Mom, I can't breathe. They snatch that thing off. You have they be in the back seat, fussing. You be trying to turn your head, fussing at them, almost wrecking your car because they won't do what you tell them to do in your own house. I mean, even back in my day when we went to school, thank God we didn't have a situation like this. But we would not be. Nobody would have kept the mask on in any of the schools I went to. Nobody would have done it. Maybe some of the white kids might have done it. A few of the white kids. A few of the white girls. But nobody I know. We would snatch them as soon as we got into the door. Looked out the door, make sure you gone. No mask. That's back. That's way back. And these children are crazier now than we ever were. Try to put a child in a circle of my foot. That's why this is not working. Anyway, according to the San Francisco Gate News, bleeding and swollen gums have been linked to severe coronavirus cases. Be aware. According to the Wall Street Journal, public release of hospital data about the coronavirus plague pandemic has slowed to a crawl 1 month after the federal government ordered states to report it directly to the Department of Health and Human Services and bypass the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. According to the Wall Street Journal, the coronavirus plague is hitting Midwestern rural areas that had previously been spared. It's all out into the country now. According to the Daily Beast, modelers are warning that Baltimore, Boston, and Chicago could be the next coronavirus hotspots. According to CBS News, a line of cars stretched for more than a mile at a food giveaway in Dallas, Texas. Dallas, Texas. The North Texas Food Bank planned to distribute enough food to support 2,000 families. Several hundred more were served at a new walk-up option being offered for families in the community without transportation. According to the Daily Mail, Dr. Fauci is warning that the death toll would be enormous if the U.S. tried to achieve herd immunity, as a new CDC model projects 189,000 to 200,000 American fatalities by September the 5th. That's just a few days away. According to the Washington Post, researchers are saying that the coronavirus death toll rivals the fatality rate during the 1918 flu epidemic. Millions died. So this is not good news. According to the Washington Post, European countries are reimposing restrictions and checks on holidaymakers in the region in response to rising coronavirus infections among people traveling within the continent. According to Herald Mail Media, the road to recovery, listen to this now, after serious coronavirus is long and some survivors may never be the same. And that is so true. According to Fox News, Connecticut has fined residents $3,000 for violating a coronavirus travel advisory. Now that you are briefed regarding what's going on with this monstrous coronavirus plague, another crisis which I told you was going to come, and I told you to get ready for the past over 100 days now, I've been giving you what I'm getting ready to give you now. Because I knew that the government, the GOV that you were trusting in, they were going to do what they're doing right now, messing around, playing games, messing around people's lives, both the Republicans and the Democrats. Cannot come to an agreement over simple stuff, leaving people in a bad situation. And I just want you to understand, people, that when your stuff is set out on the street from an eviction or from a foreclosure situation, the truth of the matter is President Trump is not going to be there to help you. Nancy Pelosi is not going to be there to help you. They're not going to come and see about you. when your children get sick, going to the public school or whatever school, and one of your children, God forbid, they die. Trump is not coming to the president. Trump is not coming to the funeral. Nobody from the White House is going to come to your funeral. Nancy Pelosi is not going to send anybody. She's not coming either. So you need to follow the big G-O-D, as I've been telling you for over 100 plus days. Not the big G-O-V. I'm thankful to God that we live in a country where people would even consider helping the people like we do in this country. But you know the government is fickle. God is not. So you need to put your faith and trust in Him, and you need to pray to Him without ceasing, and you need to follow His leadership. I'm here as God's servant to tell you what I believe God is telling me to tell you to do. And I've been telling you for over 100 days, you need to find another place to stay. You need to downsize. No more fake prosperity gospel foolishness. This includes preachers as well. You need to downsize too. With the quickness. If you're dependent upon offerings of the people, that's not coming in, my friend. And so if you're living in a big fine house on Pork Chop Hill and with a $5,000-$6,000 mortgage, $20,000 taxes, utilities, and all of that, you need to sell that. If the church only gives all the money to the church, and I'm sure they'll help you find a nice little ranch house, 3-bedroom ranch house out in the country, or a double wide or something. And you need to give all the money to the people who need it. Give them money back. Now, you pastors, God has blessed you to have enterprises and businesses, and you got books and stuff. We understand you're going to be all right, but you ought to use some of that money to help your people. Your house is probably paid for. You paid for it yourself. That's fine. But pastors who have been living off of the people, you got to sell all that. Your Bentley, your Cadillac. Now you can keep the Cadillac. Sell your Bentley, sell your Mercedes, and all that. It's all unnecessary. Your Range Rover. Sell all that. Sell that big fine house on Pork Chop Hill. That'll bring in a good cool $2 million, and give it all to the people, and help them to survive, get them set up in one of these houses that I'm getting ready to tell y'all about. You can buy off-grid housing from farmflip.com. Farmflip.com was created and is managed by former land brokers and features one of the largest sources of land listings. Land buyers, land professionals from across the nation. I know it's hard for you to let go of your house and let go of what you worked so hard for. And some of you, this is your first, you're the first generation to even own a house, a decent house in a decent neighborhood. I know all about it. But when God tells you to move, you need to move. When the situation changes, you must change. Wise people change. I know you hate for me to say it, but all of the rich white folks have moved out of New York, and it's a mess. Rich black folks, too. Rich Jews and Italians and everybody, they're moving out of New York because they don't believe the city, New York City particularly. Not out of New York State. They moved upstate. They're still in New York, but they're out in the country somewhere. And people have done that all across this country. Rich folks, they moved a long time ago out into the country. places out there where you can't even see the house from the road. So deep. Okay, you may not be able to do like them, but you can do something, and I'm trying to help you to do that. The next thing you can do is buy a mobile home, a modular home, as they call it today. I know you never thought about living in a mobile home or a modular home or a double wide. I know you haven't, because you've been listening to the prosperity gospel and all of that all of these years. But you need to forget all of that. Because, see, this is bad, and it's going to get worse, people. Don't wait till people, you're going to see mass evictions, mass foreclosures, people living out on the street, living in tents. Somebody talked about today, bread riots, people fighting over food in the great state of Texas. The great state, if you will, of North Texas. A line over a mile long. Of people in the great state of North Texas, a state by itself, North Texas, Dallas. That ought to tell you something, people, because that's normally not the case in North Texas. Just not normally. There is some of it, but not much. Not like that. And this is the first time I've ever heard of it in North Texas. There are many rich people in Texas. And so that ought to tell you something. And that's going to be worse. The lines are going to be 20 miles long. You need to downsize real quick. If you haven't done so, you're really late. You need to do it now. I'm waiting on the big gov, the big G-O-V. Listen, I hate to say it, but that's not wise. Let me just say it that way. Okay? That's not wise at all. And by the way, whoever is the president, makes no difference at this point. If they don't overturn what Obama and Biden did and what Trump has done to sanction homosexuality in the American government, this is going to get worse. This is going to continue, and it's going to get worse. And the next plague is not going to, listen to me carefully. The next plague is not going to give you the opportunity to run and hide. It's just going to come on inside the house and kill you. It's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. God does not play people. And He's not playing with us. The old saints used to say, the will of God grinds slow, but it grinds sure. And you can believe that. So go to palmharborhomes.com. Palm Harbor Homes is one of the nation's largest builders of manufactured homes and modular homes. Last time I checked, the sale is probably off now. And see, this is what I want you to do. Now, when I say move and downsize, I'm talking about move and downsize is something that you can pay for, that you can own, and you don't have any payments other than a few little utilities or whatever. No payments, man. No payment. Because, see, that's not going to work. Because you can't have payments if you don't have a paycheck. No payments if you don't have a paycheck. You understand? No paycheck, there's no money for payments. And you know why most of those people were in that line in Dallas? Because they don't have a job. And by the way, if you have a car payment, you need to be seeing how you can get rid of that and get you a car that's paid for. If you don't have a job. Now, if you have a job, like my daughter has a job at home, then you're good to go. You make your payments. But if you don't have a job, you can't have payments. So I'm hoping and praying that you would sell your house, do it on your own with them, and sell it back to the people. No foreclosure papers. Make sure they don't have any foreclosure words on your paperwork. And you go ahead and give Bubba his house back and do it on your own. And he may be generous and kind and give you $30,000 or $40,000 equity, even though you didn't really quite reach that point, but to just help you out because you're doing the right thing. You're being a stand-up guy and a stand-up gal, and you're saying, y'all know what the deal is. I can't pay for this. I can't pay no $2,000, $3,000, $4,000 a month. So if y'all can give me equity, some equity on this, I can buy one of these Palm Harbor homes they have on sale where you can buy a 3-bedroom modular home over here for $29,000 cash money. See. And I got some other things here that are cheaper for you. Now, the first houses that I mentioned, off-grid housing, that's out in the country, out. You know, some of you have traveled around Texas. You know, they have houses where, you know, this big old fence on a farm and everything, and you don't even see the house from the street. They have a gate, electric gate and everything. You know, it's a ranch. You don't even see the house. And you can't get up in there. That's what that is about. Okay. Off-grid housing where you got solar panels, you got your own water system, and you're not even connected to the city at all. Got a septic tank and all that out there. Out in the country. Okay, so the modular homes, the double wides, or you can get a single wide for cheaper than that. You get a single wide cheaper than that. Pay for it cash. Now you say, well, I don't want to do that. You know, I'm the head and not the tail. Well, you're going to be the tail if you don't move your tail out of that house, and you're going to be out in the street. And you and your children are not going to have a place to stay. And what you need to do is get out of the weather. You don't need to be out there in the street trying to find a place and homeless shelters and all that. Move while you can. And you're late right now. Stop. See what the government is doing with you? This little game they're playing here, this foolishness, playing with your life, that's going to last all the way to the election. And then it's going to get worse after that. I don't care who wins. I'm not on anybody's side. Because it's all going to hell in a handbasket if they don't repent of their sin. If the church does not repent and lead these people in politics to repent of sanctioning the abomination of homosexuality, and not to mention their own adultery and fornication and foolishness, taking pictures with your drawers open, out and open, and all this kind of mess, hugging on people you're not married to. Third option, you can buy a mini house or a tiny house at tinyhousefinder.net. Tinyhousefinder.net. Tiny House Finder is the dedicated real estate site for tiny houses where you can find tiny houses for sale or rent. You can also find builders and lots to place your tiny house on. Okay? That's the thing. I know you have never heard of it, probably, but that's the thing. There are people who live in tiny houses. I saw a house just yesterday where it looks like a big house on the front from the street, but the depth is like, you know, and they live in that. Some of you have seen these tiny houses. Whatever you need to do to get out of high rent and high mortgages and get a roof over your head, I strongly advise you to do that. Stop hoping for America to be America again like it used to be. Those days are long gone. Have you ever heard of the new normal? Well, you might as well get used to this. And then your next option, and I have it fourth, not because it's the worst option, it may be the best option for you. There's nothing like a great RV, a great motorhome, a great fifth wheel, a great trailer. It's just made for this kind of a situation. Okay, there's nothing like it. It's built for a situation like this. It is absolutely amazing what they have done on wheels with motorhomes and trailers and fifth wheels. Oftentimes, you find some motorhomes far more plush than your house. That's a motorhome that the wall is like, I don't know what it is. The walls are made out of this beautiful cushiony thing. I don't even know why they do it. I guess for sound, I don't know. Cushiony kind of a thing on the wall. And the leather, you get some nice places, man. The leather is for real in some of these motorhomes, fifth wheels, travel trailers. And it's just very convenient. So if you want to do that, you can buy one of those cash. And if you're at a certain age, that's what you should do anyway. I know you don't like for me to say it, but the rich white folks, that's what they've been doing for years. Years. They sell their house after they raise their children. They're approaching retirement and Social Security time. And they buy a motorhome, they pay for it cash, that's paid for. And then they move it to where they want to move it to, and they can get a good deal at certain places for where you don't pay no more than $350 a month to park your motorhome. And the only other thing you pay is electricity. You don't pay water, you don't pay any, only other bill is electricity. And they don't burn that much electricity. So if you're getting $2,000 from your Social Security, just from your Social Security alone, not from your investments, your IRA, your 401, none of that, just your Social Security alone can pay for that easily, and you still got room to spare. So don't poo-poo on getting a motorhome. That's a cool thing to do now. There are young people doing it now. I know of a couple. They send me stuff all the time. A young couple. They just had their first baby. And I think they're still in their 20s. But they've already paid off their student loans. You know how? By living and traveling and working from their motorhome. See, that's another thing, too. When you downsize, you can go ahead on and by faith start a business. Because you don't need a whole lot of money to live on. You don't have a whole lot of overhead. You don't have to get it. You can work from home in your pajamas. So go to Motorhome Specialists. where the world shops. The website is mhsrv.com. Okay? Let me repeat that. I want you to get that. mhsrv.com. National RV is one of the most experienced and largest recreational vehicle manufacturers in the United States. Don't depend on the big GOV now. I told you. Don't. You know better than that. You know better than that. Don't do that. And I'm being nice about it. Don't do that. Depend on the big G-O-D. Depend on God. Pray to Him. And He'll lead you. He'll guide you. He'll open up doors for you. We're going to see whether or not you got all that favor now. See, if you got God's favor on you, but you got to understand now, you can't have God's favor on you if you're shacking up. You got Bo Peep coming over every week. You seeing Sylvia every week. You got a side piece, 2 and 3 side pieces. You're trying to be a heterosexual and a homosexual. No, you're not going to have any favor on you, see. Everybody's going to see that. That you all this, how you doing? Oh, I'm blessed and highly favored. Oh, really? Okay, well, that needs to be kicking in about right now. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. That needs to be kicking in about right now. And by the way, as I've said before, if you were in that line yesterday, hear me? Well, I'm being nice as I can be about it. If you were in the line yesterday to get food, you should have moved 2 months ago. Or at least a month ago. Because see, if you do what I'm telling you to do, you can go to the grocery store and buy your own food. Stop trying to keep up with the Joneses and the Johnsons and everybody else. You're not them. You got to do what you got to do. And if you have to move, you need to move. You don't have to tell anybody, just move. You don't need to tell anybody because they may want to try to find you. And if you have God's favor, God's going to give you a sweet spot. And you don't want anybody else coming messing up your sweet spot. God may give you a place out in the rural or some out in the rural area, country or whatever, and some of your friends want to come out with Black Lives Matter foolishness and so forth. You don't need that. You don't need to bring that out there. You don't need that because they run you out of there and them. So you just leave. And you get into your spot where God wants you to be. And if things clear up, they'll hear about you. They'll hear about it from you or somebody later on down the road. But you got to be careful with people trying to get a hookup. You got to follow the Lord to get your family hooked up. Okay. And so you don't tell everybody your business, where you're going, what you're doing. They might beat you there, and then you won't have a place to stay. All right, let me talk to you briefly about homeschooling. My wife and I, we homeschool our children from the time they were born until they graduated from college. Many people don't know this. I went to seminary online at Liberty University. I went to undergraduate face-to-face. But I did that because my oldest daughter, she wanted to do the face-to-face college thing as well, and I didn't want her to do that. And I thank God for my daughter, my oldest daughter, Danny. She didn't want to do it. She didn't like it initially, but she submitted. And she went on, and God has blessed her life. And so I went online because she didn't want to go online. And I had already been through the face-to-face stuff, and And I didn't want her to be involved with the foolishness that I saw. And so I went online myself so that she would feel more comfortable about going online. And it was one of the best things we ever did. This is after homeschooling them for all those years. IXL review from the homeschoolmom.com. Write that website down. She will help you get through this process. And by the way, major counties, major cities, such as Richardson, I believe, Frisco, McKinney, you know what they're doing? They're teaching children at home. And then they're learning. They're smart. They're smart. They're not trying to do that foolishness. That is so stupid to me. I'm telling you, I don't know what is possessing these people to talk about this even, other than selfishness, politics. But I thank God these major cities, where there are many very smart people, and yes, many of them are in these areas are rich too. And it's easier for them. I give you that. But you got to do what you got to do. That's what I'm telling you. If you got to downsize to homeschool your children, then you got to downsize to homeschool your children. Your children come first. Sacrifice for your children. And in time to come, everything will come out, just work out just fine. You take care. You love on your children. Take care of your children. And you might have to live in a shack or whatever while you raise them. And one day, God, because you loved on them and you trained them and you taught them and you disciplined them, they may go out and buy them a house and buy you a house. Many, many young people have done that for their parents. Good parents, though. Not sorry, selfish. No good parents who don't care for their children. And the children know the difference, by the way. I don't know what you're thinking. You can't fool children, man. With resources for pre-K to 8th grade, IXL Math is a good site for practice and drill. While the site also has a paid membership that includes comprehensive coverage of math skills, the free access provides plenty of interactive practice on a variety of skills arranged by age and topic. The coverage meets state standards and tracks your child's progress. All right, we're still talking about the kind of schedule you want to choose. You can go by the public school schedule. Or you can create your own schedule. This is part 7, and this is called let me share that with you. This is called so what is a good schedule for homeschooling? This is part 7. Now this schedule is called the shift work schedule. The shift work schedule. Some families have a parent who is working a more unusual shift or schedule, such as a hospital nurse or a firefighter who works 3 or 4 days on and 3 or 4 days off. Homeschooling can be coordinated to take place while the parent is working, if the other parent is an at-home parent. And somebody, now if you're going home, listen to me. I hope you understand. You can't leave the children home because it's homeschooling. You can't do that. At no time, at no point. I think that's illegal. If it's not, it should be. And let me help you now. You can't leave your teenager in charge of the homeschool.
For some of y'all who might be thinking, I hope you're not thinking that way.
You got to be in the house. You've got to be in the house. Now, if you make a priority for God and for your children, he will work it out for you. He'll give you a job in the house. But you need to be there for that to work. Now, homeschooling, you must understand, the parent being involved is a given. Okay? The parent has to be there. There's no homeschooling without the parent. I know some of y'all are trying to make up little pod schools, and you're trying to make up, trying to get people who have a degree and to come teach 6 or 7, 8 of your friends and your girlfriend so y'all can go sip some tea, do some whatever in the world you're doing. That's not homeschooling. You just created a school, and you're paying a teacher who probably has coronavirus, the coronavirus plague, and or who will get it from one of your children, and then we got a big old mess on our hands. I know some of you all are trying to get out of this homeschooling thing, trying to hire people and all this, and honey, talking about honey child, I can't do that. I'm not going to do it. You can do it. And you need to do it. Because it's really not all about you teaching them, because they got other people who can do that online, but it's about you being there with them, in the house with them. You can still work a job at the house. As long as they know they can come put hands on you and get a bologna sandwich or something. this way, time off can be maximized with togetherness rather than worries about academics. Another approach may be scheduling the academics purposely during the off shift. This way, in a two-parent family, both parents can participate in the homeschooling process. Or in a single-parent family, the homeschooling can take place during time off with child care covering the work hours, so forth. Okay? So there's different ways you can do it. And you've got to do what you've got to do. And you've got to follow the big G-O-D, not the big G-O-V. See? Okay? So with that said, ladies and gentlemen, let's have a word of prayer. Holy Father God, we pray in the holy name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, so many people are confused tonight. So many people are baffled about what's going on. So many people have been caught by surprise. And they still have not accepted the fact that this is happening and that this is real. It's like a dream to them. So, Lord, Holy Father God, we pray, if they are already saved, that you will now help them to understand the importance of prayer to you. And Lord, we pray that you will lead them and guide them and direct them to make the right decisions for themselves and for their families. And Holy Father God, we pray that you would help us all who name the name of Christ to humble ourselves, to pray, to seek your face, and to turn from our wicked ways, to repent and to get back to you, our first love. and to get back to our first works. And Holy Father God, we pray tonight for those two families. There are many, many more, but tonight we just pray for the family in Mississippi, the wife who buried her husband today. Lord, comfort her and her family as only you can. And Holy Father God, we pray for the children who buried their father and mother, I believe it was yesterday, out in Oakland. Comfort those children as only you can. Draw them all to yourself for salvation and comfort. Draw them all to your Holy Scriptures for salvation and comfort. And we pray for the son, 18-year-old son, who lost both his mother and father. And Lord, under normal circumstances, all of these people could have easily lived another 20, 30 years, easily, by your grace. That's what's so tragic about it. They were cut off in the middle of their lives, leaving children behind. Lord, that's hard. I have not experienced anything like that yet. But Lord, as you know, Lord, I know that we are no better than they. And so our day may come. And help everybody to understand that and realize that no matter how saved they think they are, Lord, the truth of the matter is the whole church is guilty. And there's no big I's and little U's in your church. And so, Holy Father God, prepare us all for when our day comes, if it comes. And give us your grace as we're asking you to give these folks grace during this difficult time. Glorify your holy name. Lift up your holy Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Save those who are under the sound of my voice. Revive those, Lord, who are already saved. In Jesus Christ's name we pray and forsake. Amen. Now, ladies and gentlemen, if you are with us today and you do not know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior and the free pardon of your sins, allow me to show you how you can place your faith and trust in Him for your soul's salvation from the power of sin, the destruction of sin, and the punishment of sin in that awful place called hell. I do want you to understand, if you have tested positive for the coronavirus plague, you need to take heed to what I'm telling you. I cannot be more earnest about it. If you're on your deathbed at the house, if you are on your, you're getting ready to be put on a ventilator at the hospital, I hate to be so blunt and so direct, but your soul is at stake. Your soul going to hell forever is imminent. It's a very serious matter. We don't have time for platitudes. We don't have time to sugarcoat anything or to make it go down easy. The truth of the matter is you're just minutes, hours, weeks, days, weeks away from the burning hell if you don't believe in the Lord Jesus Christ tonight. So first, please understand with me, dear friend, that you are a sinner. and that you have broken God's laws. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, and that includes you. We all have failed God, everybody. I'm no better than you are. I'm just as much of a sinner as you are. I'm just a beggar telling other beggars where the bread is, and I mean that, salvation-wise. So please understand, dear friend, that because of your sins, you deserve, and I deserve, and the Pope deserves, and Joel Osteen deserves, and the Dalai Lama deserves, and all of the nice people you can name deserve to die and go to hell. To die and go to hell. For the Bible says in Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. This includes physical death and spiritual death in hell. The body goes to the grave when we die. Your body will go to the grave. If the coronavirus plague has its way with you, your body will go to the grave. Your soul will go to hell if you have never trusted Christ as your Savior. If you have never believed in the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. Now, dear friend, Jesus Christ preached more on hell than anybody in the Bible. He preached more on hell than any writer, any preacher, any prophet in the Bible. That's why he came to die, to save your soul from hell. That's one of the reasons why he preached so much on it. He preached more on hell than he did about heaven. Jesus Christ described hell as a place where the worm dieth not and the fire is not quenched. If I were you, I would be willing to repent of my sins and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ said, in describing hell, it is a place of weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth due to the pain in hell. And this goes on forever and forever. Unrelenting. Never ending. That's how bad sin is to a holy God. So either you're going to pay for your sins in hell, or you're going to believe in Christ who already paid for your sins, because John the Baptist said, behold the Lamb of God. The Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, the sacrificial Lamb of God, who has taken away the sin of the world. Your sin and mine. Let me help you. You're lying. Have you ever lied before? Yes, you have. You're stealing. Regardless of value, have you ever stolen anything? I don't care if it was a cookie out of your mother's cookie jar. You're guilty. Have you ever lusted in your heart after people and things? If you lusted after somebody, you've already committed adultery in your heart, according to Jesus Christ. So you're coveting and you're committing adultery at the same time. That's two commandments. Have you ever been disrespectful to your parents? Have you ever dishonored your parents and disobeyed your parents? Sure you have. Have you ever taken God's name in vain? Even with cursing. That's just five or six of the Ten Commandments that you have broken. you're guilty. And if you have never trusted in Jesus Christ as your Savior, just for those five or six sins, you're going to spend eternity in hell. Now, here's what's happening right now in your mind. Just like you don't believe that this plague will kill you, you don't believe that there's a hell. But my dear friend, your unbelief will never change the fact of the eternal burning hell. So sin and hell are bad news. But I have some good news for you. Found in John 3:16 in the New Testament from the mouth of Jesus Christ himself. For Jesus Christ said in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." The phrase in this verse, "for God so loved the world," means that if you are in this world, God loves you. If you're still in this world, God loves you. Now, if a person is in hell already, then he's separated from God forever. That's a part of hell, being separated from God, being separated from Jesus, being separated from mercy, love, and grace. And by the way, there's no such thing, tell the Pope, there's no such thing as purgatory. And he knows it. It's not even in his Bible. Something made up in medieval times. There's no limbo, there's no in-between, there's no second chance. Is up or down, is in or out, is heaven or hell. God so loved the world. God loves you no matter what you have done or who you did it with. That's how much God loves you. He loves you so much. He sent his only begotten Son. He gave up his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer, bleed, and die on the cross for your sins. He was buried and rose on the third day. He paid your sin debt. All you have to do is believe in him. The next phrase, that he gave his only begotten Son, refers to Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, who never committed a sin in word, in thought, or in deed. Jesus Christ, who went about doing good and working miracles, showing that he was God in the flesh and is God in the flesh. He walked on the water like we walk on carpet because he made it. He made the water. He told the wind to be quiet and the waves to sit down, and they obeyed him. He raised Lazarus and others from the dead. He fed the hungry miraculously. He gave sight to the blind and hearing to the deaf. There was no doubt, and there is no doubt, that he is the God-man, Jesus Christ, the Messiah, Emmanuel, God with us. And then he chose to suffer and to bleed and to die on the cross for your sins and for mine. Was buried, and on the third day he rose from the dead by the power of God. And all you have to do is do what he said. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth. So our next phrase is that whosoever believeth in him. The word whosoever means anybody at any time. Red, yellow, black, or white. Educated or uneducated. Rich or poor. President or pauper. Makes no difference. Whosoever. Anybody at any time. Next phrase, believeth in him. That means to trust in him, to have faith in him, to rely on him, to depend upon him. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Very simple. It's nothing hard about it. Just believe in Jesus Christ, that he suffered, bled, and died on the cross for your sins. He paid your sin debt. He was buried, and then on the third day, he rose from the dead by the power of God. Why not? He raised people from the dead. Don't be shocked that he rose from the dead. His name is Jesus. Then the phrase believeth in him means to trust in him, to depend upon him, to rely on him, to have faith in him for your salvation. I want you to get that. And then our next phrase, should not perish, refers to eternal punishment in a place called hell forever. Should not perish means you can be saved from that awful place called hell. Saved from hell and saved to heaven to be with God, as it says in the next phrase, but have everlasting life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And dear friend, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ right now, right where you are. You don't have to be in a church, and in most cases, you can't go to a church right now. So just believe in Jesus Christ right where you are in your heart. You understand that once you believe in Christ, you will be repenting, turning away from your old life. The Bible says in Romans 10, 9 and 13, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou you shalt be saved. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So, dear friend, believe in your heart in the Lord Jesus Christ. Believe the full gospel according to the scriptures, that Jesus Christ suffered, bled, and died on the cross for your sins. He paid your sin debt, was buried, and rose on the third day. Get your eternal life insurance policy squared away today. Because the truth of the matter is, you could be dead by tomorrow morning. I know that sounds rather forward and dark and straightforward, but it is true. People are dying of the coronavirus plague, and they didn't even know they had it. So trust in Christ right now while you have a chance, and get saved from that awful place called hell, and get saved to that beautiful place called heaven, where the streets of gold are so pure, they're transparent like glass. You can see right through it. Get your eternal life insurance policy squared away. Already paid for in full. It is free. It's a gift. Paid for and signed in the blood of Christ. So right now, dear friend, call on his name, believing in your heart in Jesus Christ. Pray and ask him to save your soul, and he will save you. I'll be more than happy to lead you in the sinner's prayer. Repeat after me, phrase by phrase, and mean it from your heart. Holy Father God, I acknowledge that I am a sinner, and I admit that I have broken your Ten Commandments. I admit that I committed the sins that the preacher talked about earlier. such as lying, stealing, lusting, disobeying and dishonoring my parents, taking your holy name in vain. For Jesus Christ's sake, please have mercy and grace upon my soul. And please forgive me of all of my sins, as I now believe with all of my heart in Jesus Christ, that he suffered and bled and died on the cross for my sins, was buried, and rose on the third day by your power. Lord Jesus, please come into my heart and into my spirit and save my soul today. Please fill me with your Holy Spirit and help me to change from my old way. Help me to repent of all of my sins, past and present. Help me to turn from my evil lifestyle. And help me to follow you, Lord Jesus, in the new life. For it is in your name I do pray. Amen. Now, dear friend of mine, if you believed in your heart in the Lord Jesus Christ, that Jesus Christ suffered, bled, and died on the cross for your sins, was buried, and rose on the third day, allow me to say to you, congratulations on doing the most important thing in life, and that is trusting Jesus Christ, believing in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. For more information to help you grow in your newfound faith in Christ, please go to GospelLightSociety.com. And read my book titled, What to Do After You Enter Through the Door. You can download that free. Jesus Christ said in John 10:9, I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved and shall go in and out and find pasture. If you believed in the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior today, please email us at dw3@gospellightsociety.com or whatever email is on your platform and let us know. We have some free material that we want to send you. If you have a prayer request, please email that to us as well, and we will pray for you until you tell us to stop. Until next time, my beloved, God loves you, we love you, and may God bless you real good. Is my prayer. By the grace of God, I'll be back here tomorrow. Let's all stand for our closing prayer. Holy Father God in heaven, we pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We praise you and we thank you for what you have done, for what you're doing, and for what you will do. Set your people free to follow you, to love you back, to fear you, to obey you, and to do your will and not theirs. We thank you, Holy Father God, for your chastening hand. And we still pray that you'll be thorough with us, break us and make us and mold us to be what you would have us to be. And Lord, help us to learn to fear you, to respect you, and to love you. Help us to humble ourselves as your people, to pray, to seek your face, and to turn from our wicked ways, to repent and to get back to you, our first love, and to do the first works. And we pray that millions would hear the gospel wherever they are in the world even on their deathbeds. Help them to believe the gospel. Help them to believe in Jesus Christ and to be saved from that awful place called hell. In Jesus Christ's name we pray and forsake. Amen. God bless you, dear friends. Until next time, if the Lord